This past Sunday was Father's Day. You may have reservations about what can be depicted as another corporate scam to sell overpriced Love You Dad cards. But for many families and children, Father's Day is an opportunity to affirm love and appreciation for Dad. However, for many men who have restricted access to their children or no access at all, Father's Day is a poignant reminder of loss that can, in extreme instances, resemble a bereavement of sorts. Fathers for Justice is a campaigning group founded to challenge the bias against men inherent in family law, both here and in Britain. Matt O'Connor is its founder, and when I spoke to him recently, I put it to him that I knew from John Mulder's campaigning in the Irish Times and the controversy that caused that this campaign is not always a popular one.
No, it's not. And John, who is a good friend of mine, has been a whipping boy, Eamon, for the rights of fathers in Ireland. We've now launched in Ireland last summer, so he's got a bit of backup, he's got a bit of support. But it is a deeply, deeply unpopular cause. Wherever I go, in the UK Parliament, the Scottish Parliament, well, it was last week, or the Irish Parliament, politicians are uncomfortable.
Yes.
Talking about the issue of fathers, the issue of fathers' rights, or fatherlessness,
yes,
of male suicide, of all the dreadful, catastrophic consequences that flow from the cancer of family breakdown and fatherlessness. You're absolutely right. It is unpopular, and it's a real struggle. I mean, I've been doing this gig,
yes,
for 16 years, and I foolishly, when I started the campaign back in 2001, I foolishly and naively thought, we'd wrap this up in 3 years.
Yeah.
Job done. Go home. Who can argue with the principle of parental equality?
Yes.
But my Lord, there's been a lot of resistance. A lot of resistance.
Just a little bit about your background, Matt. You're, from your accent, I gather, you're British. Londoner?
All over. My father was from Sneem.
In Kerry.
In the county Kerry. Family in Kerry. I spend a lot of time in Kerry. But obviously from my accent, people, yes, naturally assume I'm English. So lived in Manchester,
yes,
Kent, London, obviously where my accent, yeah, was finely honed and tuned.
Yes.
But when I spend time, when I was in the UK, I used to get flack sometimes for having an Irish name,
yes,
and then spend time in Ireland, you get flack for having an English accent. So you can't win. But yeah. I'm a sort of hybrid of hopefully the best of Irish and British. I'm hoping.
Now, the tell me about the catalyst for this, your own experience of family breakup.
Yeah, it was...
Which I assume was the catalyst for this. Do I assume rightly?
You do assume rightly, Eamon. And, you know, I was I was not, put my hands up myself, was not the world's greatest husband, to be fair. But I don't think I was ever a terrible dad. And myself and my ex-wife went through what started off as a fairly amicable separation and divorce. I didn't want to get divorced. I had no intention of separating from her. I loved her. And it was an extremely painful and difficult experience. And what really took me apart, literally, was the fact that one day we're living with my children.
How old were they?
They were probably around about sort of 3 and 5.
And what were their names?
Daniel was my oldest, and Alexander was my sort of youngest. And so I was living with them. I was doing all the normal things you do at home. And then we separated. The solicitors got involved. And it became extraordinarily complicated. I eventually left the family home. And I just found myself just excommunicated from my own flesh and blood, my own family. I had to apply to a court to try and see my children. I had to prove, somehow prove it was in their interest for them to see me. There's no presumption of parental rights.
Yes.
You have no rights.
Yes.
So this baptism of fire began, and it was pre my divorce. It's fairly to say I was a bit of a hedonist. I was, you know, enjoyed life.
Yeah. Can I just clarify something in case people who are listening wonder? Marriages break up. There was no domestic violence.
No.
Or any issues of that nature. I just want to be clear
I'll be clear. What the catalyst was, I was having a relationship with somebody else.
Yeah.
What came out in the wash was that my wife had stopped loving me many years beforehand. I'd obviously didn't feel...
Yeah, it happens.
Relationships break down.
Yeah.
And that's what happened. And so when you end up in the family courts, be it in Ireland or be it in England, Wales, Scotland, you have the general principles of law are the same. You have no legal presumption of contact with your children, i.e. you have no rights in law to see your children. There's no presumption of shared parenting or equal parenting. So you have to go in and you have to prove it's in the children's best interest for them to see you. This is a principle they introduced in Ireland a few years ago.
Yeah.
The child's best interest principle.
Yeah.
And that principle is decided by a judge, unelected, unaccountable, unsackable, operating in a secret court.
Is it fair to assume then that if the separation divorce becomes antagonistic, as a means of punishing the father, it's in the interests of the mother to depict the father as a problem if he were to continue seeing his children?
It can be. The best... My children become like human shields.
Yes, I understand this.
Like the hostage, they're like the weapon and
the
shield.
I understand that.
The best way of punishing somebody you used to love, but you might have resentments about now, who may be unfaithful to you, who you feel has done you some kind of wrong, is to stop them seeing the people they love the most, which is the children. And the court system, particularly in Ireland, is absolutely prehistoric.
Yes.
Jurassic judges operating in secrecy. It is brutal. It is like legalised cage fighting. Courts have no place. Families have no place in courts. Courts are for criminals, not families. It's an adversarial system, law, as we know. But in the case of families, it pitches parent against parent. You have maximum conflict and therefore maximum damage done to the family, to the mother, the father, the children, the grandparents who go through double the heartbreak. They go for it for themselves and they go for it for their children. It's a lose-lose scenario.
And in your own case, what was the outcome in terms of your access?
Well, I got to a point, Eamon, where I was very difficult. I got to a point where I was drinking too much. I was depressed. My business partner had been killed at the time. The group of companies that he had went bust. So at one point, I had literally 15 quid in my pocket. I was living in a company flat that was about to be foreclosed on. Couldn't see my kids, couldn't get to my own home, had nothing.
You described it one in one thing. I think you've given articles, interviews and written articles for many magazines, GQ and in the UK, Esquire, and so on. You describe that separation from your children, the loss of them effectively, as a feeling of bereavement, like bereavement. I understand that. Can you elaborate slightly on that?
Yeah, it is. The pain is immeasurable, and I've never known pain like it. And to lose your children who are still alive, it is what I call a living bereavement. And this pain, I mean, it drove me to the brink of suicide. So for me, it was a real struggle to try and... when all around me my life was like ground zero, there was just rubble. I had to try and find a way of crawling back and getting back through that. And I ended up in court one day. I'm not sure I'm allowed to swear on this.
You are.
But I was in court and I'd had enough.
Yeah.
I could not emotionally continue. And I said to the judge, I'm going to put out of a fucking job. If it's the last thing I do on God's earth, I will come back and I will sort this out and I will make sure we have parental equality in this country. And I walked out of the court, and the court welfare officer, the CAFCA officer, said, Mr. O'Connor, where are you going? You can't walk away. I said, I'm done. I cannot continue. I'm broken.
What were your own legal people representing you telling you about?
Well, I'd run out of cash.
Or did you?
I'd run out of cash at that point.
So you were representing yourself?
I was representing myself.
You've got no chance.
Well, I think we have a lot of chance with legal. You can bankrupt yourself and go to court and pay for legal representation. Yes. The court system doesn't work. But what happened after that event was interesting, because after that event, within 2 weeks, the children were up staying with me for Christmas that year. And whatever happened on the part of my ex-wife, she'd obviously gone, maybe I pushed them to the limit.
Yes.
And then contact was restored, the children were up seeing me. And bizarrely, at that point, it was resolved.
Yes.
And so I found myself in the position then of you know, feeling something needed to be done about the situation, because at that time I was a father of two boys. I'm now a father of three boys.
Yes.
And I feel a deep sense of responsibility, you know, to people I help day to day, but yes, also to them as a father. And people say, why are you still doing this after 16 years? And I do it because I care about my children. I don't want my boys or anybody else's children to go through what I went through.
So I know also that John Waters, in his work in the Irish Times and elsewhere, but particularly in the Irish Times, did counsel men who were found themselves in this position.
Hmm.
And did tell your story and tell the story of men like you. And some of the stories are horrible stories. It's when you started Fathers for Justice in 2001, your objective was a reform of the law. Is that correct?
Yeah, my objective was a bit hazy back in the day, because I was a force of nature. My objective was justice. That's what, yes. You know, when we were coming up with a name, we went through several alliterations, but we wound up with Fathers, yes, for Justice. It did what it said on the tin.
Yes.
But the overriding presumption then, really as it is now, is establishing parental equality. Why don't we? We have equality for everybody. We have equality for minorities. We have equality for every type of person in society. But we don't have equality for fathers. So I was fighting for the peace. I'm fighting to, let's have a system that works, yes, for families, that actually works for children, that is less adversarial. And that was our starting point. So when I started the campaign, it was forged in this out, yes, of the pain that I'd been through. But fairly early on, Bob Geldof was chipping in. And I don't know if you've met Bob, but he's a force of
I haven't met him,
a force of nature himself.
He's an amazing guy,
and he was very vocal at that time about the rights of fathers. He'd been through his experience with Paulie Yates, so he was a sort of significant motivating factor as well in terms of what we were doing as a campaign group. But I don't think back in the day, back then, I could have realised that I'd still be the longevity of the campaign.
Yes.
The amount of resistance we meet and the determination and resilience we would need to show and demonstrate as a campaign group. Because the more you kind of peel back this veneer, like in Ireland, it's what I call the GAA veneer.
Yeah.
The veneer that everything for men is brilliant. If you look at the GAA,
yeah,
rugby, football, you think, oh, it's all fabulous, it's going great, yeah, for men and guys.
Yes.
But you peel that back, there's some profound damage being done, like the suicide epidemic, yes, in Ireland. You get 11 men every week taking their own lives. Yes. You know, you look at it.
It's four or five times the number of road deaths.
So yeah, exactly. And it's a scandal. It's a scandal that politicians aren't doing anything about it. So we've got to start a conversation in Ireland.
Yeah, let me, at this stage, I mean, this is one of the very interesting aspects of it, why politicians won't take the calls up, and why perhaps the justice system is the way it is. There's a kind of, the dice are loaded here, because traditionally, historically, going back, and in certain cultures, men have not been good fathers. Men have not nurtured as much as they might have, or wouldn't have that this is a presumption, wouldn't have the nurturing gene that women have.
I wouldn't agree with that at all.
I'm not saying I agree with it. What I'm saying is, as what makes it so unpopular as a cause, and what attracted the hostility you faced, Bob Geldof has faced, and John Waters faced spectacularly in this country, a lone voice and regarded as a crank, is men aren't great at stuff, and family responsibility is one of the things sometimes they're not great at.
I think that's bollocks, frankly. I really do. Okay. And I tell you why it's bollocks is because, and I think John actually raised this as an issue. Our roles as men and women were predetermined by biology.
Yes.
So men could do the heavy lifting, worked in the fields. Women biologically were giving birth to children and child rearing. And that has conditioned our thinking for thousands of years.
Yes.
What's happened in the last 50 years, a very, very short period of time, is that the roles have evolved. And men and women now are capable of doing the same function. So biologically, a child will form its closest bond with whoever the primary carer is. Doesn't need to be the mother, it can be the father.
At that point, can I again challenge you? You quite at liberty to offer the same response. I actually believe personally that there is a difference psychologically between men and women in terms of child rearing and nurture. I don't think they're the same.
I don't think there's any scientific evidence for that, Eamon. I do respect your view, and you know.
Well, because of the way God made us, men, as you said before, do the heavy lifting, build the buildings, do the stuff, have to go out and provide. And
but that's changed. That is changing. Right. A third of all childcare in the UK, for example, is now done by men.
You might be able to straighten me out by the end of the conversation. I wouldn't like to be a house husband.
Yeah. Well, let me tell you,
I feel it's
if
not
it was
my
the
nature.
Way you said it was, why do I represent 80,000 fathers who are all fighting for the family courts trying to see their children?
Yes.
I mean, if this was not an issue, if that's...
Oh, no, I think it is an issue.
But,
and I think it's a very serious and important issue, and it's a blank spot.
But these are dads. Let me tell you, these are dads who want to be hands-on, loving parents, looking after and caring for their children. Not part-time. Not these are committed fathers. In fact, if you look at Sweden, where they have proper paternity leave, they used to back in the '80s, less than 1% of couples shared the care after separation. Now that figure is 40%. So this presumption of shared parenting, which I campaign for, which is deeply unpopular at the moment, but actually in Sweden, it's increasing, 40% of couples after separation. In America, 22 US states in America are now introducing a presumption of shared parenting. That means fathers are going to be integrally involved in the raising and well-being and looking after their children, and that is important. That's a significant shift. Yeah. I think culturally, you're right.
No, it's something I totally support.
Yeah, but I think the cultural difference, I think what you're talking about is the cultural difference.
Well, yeah, the idea of perhaps the person who is there in the home to provide meals, to be there when kids get home from school, to make sure they have their food boxes in the morning, they're dressed and that and that. Now, I'm 71. So maybe I'm just a dinosaur who doesn't get it. But I also would consider myself to be a feminist. So women's rights to do and live as they want, sure. But I still believe that if you only have to look at the physical strength of men as opposed to women, there are certain things that women can't do. I think... Let me put this to you, that women's nurturing is natural. They have the children.
Complete bollocks.
They have the children.
I don't know what...
They have the children. They breastfeed the children. But does that not count for anything?
I think...
Or count for very little?
I think that's a very traditional view. That's the politest way I can put it. I think that's a very... traditional view shaped by the way we are being shaped as a society.
Right.
That is changing massively. I mean, Gloria Steinem is a feminist. I say I'm not a feminist, but Gloria Steinem is a feminist, said women cannot have equality outside the home until men are equal in it. You're going to see a massive change in the way that mothers and fathers and the roles of the genders are going to be valued by society. And I think if we want women to be independent, my selling argument on shared parenting when I was in the Scottish Parliament last week is very simple. If we want women to be independent, we want women to be free, if we want women to pursue their own careers, to start their own businesses, that requires men to be involved in child rearing. That involves not just men, but the paternal grandparents as well. What's the, you know, given the exorbitant cost of childcare, who are the best people to provide childcare in the family? And that's obviously the paternal grandparents.
Okay.
So let's involve the family. Let's get people to get more constructive, positive solutions involving men and women, mothers, you know, fathers, mothers, sisters, brothers coming together. And I think the roles that you've said, you've outlined, the traditional roles of the genders, that's gone. That's history.
Let me wind the clock back 50 years. I'm starting out again. I'm 21, right? I'm playing for Millwall, which is the only way we can get money and a house. You don't want me to go back in the house because my wife can't play for Millwall.
Yeah, but
now,
today,
I'm not trying to be tricky.
No, today she might be, well, I tell you what, you might be at home and she might be working for Yahoo or Google or Facebook in Dublin and earning more money than you.
Yeah.
And you might say, right, well, I'm going to look after the kids because she's earning more money. That's the reality in today's Ireland.
Okay. I got it. Now, the concept you speak of, shared parenting, tell me, sketch that out for me.
Well, it's an old-fashioned...
So, let's say I'm 21.
Yeah.
I meet a girl. We fall in love. We get married, which I did when I was 21, believe it or not. That's guaranteed. To, you know, be come out wrong.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, you get married. What happens next?
Well, in
life, you decide to have children. So what happens next? I'm working. She's working. Go.
Well, if the relationship breaks down, I presume that's what you'll
No, I want to know what it is from the start. The shared parenting thing, because. I would consider that I was a very good father. Read bedtime stories, doted, picked the kids up from school because my football job allowed me to do that. And I just lived for that. That's why I understand your concept of bereavement. But what I'm asking you is, when you say shared parenting, is that it?
No, the presumption, what we're saying is that after separation at the moment, after separation...
I'm talking before... you mean it should be shared parenting after separation?
Well, there should always be, right?
Yeah.
Every relationship should be underpinned by it. So relationships are never black and white, but the law should be. Right. And what we say is, you know, we have a role here to instruct people, mothers and fathers, to understand they've got rights, they should have rights, along with the responsibilities. At the moment... we don't have that. And there is the presumption, which you've outlined, which is that mothers are the primary carers and dads are somehow disposable.
Yeah.
That we now have a nation of sperm banks and cash points. So you can abandon your children tomorrow, provided you pay, and you have a responsibility to pay for children you can't see. And that is a damaging presumption. What we've got to do is, going back to the original starting point, is that if you enter a relationship, you know, both parents should know that in the event you do separate, there is a presumption of shared parenting, there is a presumption of parental equality, not this winner-takes-all system that says, mum shall have the kids, mum shall have the house, mum shall have the money, winner-takes-all, I cash in, and the daddy is left over here in the bedsit on his knees, paying for children he can't see.
And I suppose in a world where mostly now two parents are working, that's more reasonable, because in a world of that I grew up in Ireland, although I know women always worked in England through working through wars and afterwards, you know, both parents did work and they were what you'd call latchkey kids. In the modern world it's different.
Well, it's worse.
Now,
I tell you what's worse.
I think
it's an important point. Yeah. I tell you what's worse is because we now live in an age where relationship breakdown is rife. which are driven by greater promiscuity on the part of women, greater promiscuity on the part of men. Yes. You have online dating, you have apps like Tinder. Yeah. Relationships are disposable.
And there's an online, you only live once, give it a go. Or something like that.
Exactly. But that is driving. That's feeding into relationship breakdown, which drives into family breakdown, which then drives into fatherlessness.
Sure. Well, in the divorce referendum here in mid-90s, I was against divorce until children were 16. I wrote a piece in Sunday Independent on the leader page, which was the biggest selling newspaper in the country, suggesting that divorce would destroy the fabric of society slowly and insidiously. And once you make a commitment by having a child, you're obliged to raise that child until they're 16, 17, and don't need you quite so much in quite the same ways. And it was only passed here by a very narrow majority, divorce. And divorce has damaged society, in my view. Do you have a view about that?
Do you know what? That's a whole other can of worms, isn't it? Yeah. Divorce. I mean, look, divorce might work for individuals and might work for people who... I think we have an emphasis on placing our own needs as individuals, as mothers and fathers, over needs for our children. Divorce can be utterly destructive and utterly damaging and utterly harmful to children.
Yeah, because there was a mantra that I heard. Children don't like... They would rather their parents split up. This was an English thing.
Yeah.
Than see them fighting all the time.
Yeah.
Now, I don't believe that's true.
That's bullshit. I mean,
there's violence involved or something extreme. But in general, I think they're quite happy as long as the two parents are there. Okay, they're bickering.
Let me tell you, in every report, I read a lot of court reports. I was reading one on the way up today. Every court report I read, most of these kids want their mums and dads to be together.
Yes.
Let me tell you, anybody who tells you anything different to that is a barefaced dishonesty.
Yes.
And that is a problem. Is when you're dealing with the issue of families and family breakdown, that we are drowning in a wave of dishonesty. A lot of it, put out there by the kind of so-called experts who support this kind of idea of a liberal society where women have somehow been enslaved to men for thousands of years and need to be free of the shackles of marriage, and marriage is a patriarchal institution. But let me tell you, you don't need to be married to have problems with parental separation. I mean, obviously you can be unmarried, and unmarried fathers and aunts have literally zero rights. So marriage doesn't protect children in that way. It doesn't protect fathers in that way. So the institution of marriage is in some respects not a particularly robust construct because the law never supports it in the way it should have done.
Now, you said you were in the Scottish Parliament last week. I know you've met with Theresa May, who's now currently the Prime Minister of Britain and likely to remain so forever, if Jeremy Corbyn hangs around.
She'll be there for a while.
For a while.
I'd say, yeah.
But you met people. And as you said, Matt, there's a fear of this subject among politicians because what is giving rise to their fear?
Well, you mentioned Theresa May. Let me just tell you a little bit about Theresa May. Me and her had a run-in after an interview in 2004. This was after we had him on Tony Blair in the House of Commons, and I think she was a minister.
What did you do to Tony Blair? Did you throw a bag of flour at him?
There was a condom loaded with self-raising flour that was coloured with purple icing colour and some glitter. And they spent £500,000 on a security screen in the House of Commons. Unfortunately, our guys were sitting in front of it. So which kind of defeated the purpose, obviously, of having spent all that money. But he was powder-bombed, between the shoulder blades and the House of Commons, and they evacuated the House of Commons, and it was a bit of a security scare for them. But that was probably the first incident that really put us on the map. But the Theresa May thing followed on from that, and that was when Michael Howard was the leader of the Conservative Party. They were in opposition, and Theresa May was the shadow, I think, Children and Families Minister. Right. And they were against shared parenting at that time. But in the space of those few months, they flipped and had this kind of what I called a Damascene conversion, which in the interview I did with Theresa May, I actually welcomed. But afterwards, she was pretty upset and came at me with a handbag. I was being filmed. There was a documentary crew filming me at the time for a Channel 4 program, and she came at me and was very angry. And I sort of hit the reverse button, and she was restrained by one of her colleagues. So, but she did.
But you were involved in this guerrilla campaigning.
We were, but you know, this is extraordinary.
Things. I mean, you might tell us about some of them.
Just go back to the interesting thing is cause and effect is we were doing high profile stuff which people condemned us for.
Yeah.
I mean, I had somebody in the Labour Party, Labour MP said, "You're the worst campaign group I've ever heard of."
Yes.
And I said, "But you have heard of us."
Yes.
And the Labour Party, of all people, was forged in the fires of civil disobedience. I mean, I was born and raised in the Labour Party. That was my party.
Yeah.
It is anymore, but it was my party. And a key part of the Labour Party was direct action, was civil disobedience, was protest. So that's why when I started Fathers for Justice, direct action was always going to be kind of quite an integral part in terms of what we did.
Yeah, I mean, you there's a bridge in Clifton in Bristol, which is very famous. It's a massive
Clifton suspension bridge. Yeah,
suspension bridge. And you did something there too.
There was I'm trying. It's going back a few years now, but there were some superheroes put up on the bridge there. I think it was in February 2014. I think we did that. Obviously, we had Batman and Buckingham Palace in September.
Tell us about Batman at Buckingham Palace.
Well, that was just, again, a simple protest. I mean, we didn't have much money. We obviously didn't have a budget for TV advertising. So, you know, you have to be creative. And
yes.
You know, it's my job to think about, well, how can we get... Yeah, my job is to get publicity for the cause.
Yes.
And so it literally, we had an idea on the Saturday afternoon. We could put Batman on Buckingham Palace, and I'd gone past in a taxi and thought, well, if you put him up on the, I think it was the Western Annex, you could put a ladder up and then run around the balcony, the ledge, onto the front of the building beside the Royal Balcony, which is effectively what they did. You know, we just literally got a superhero suit from fancy dress shop, got a window cleaning ladder, and they just off they went, and that's all it took.
So it was really just name recognition. Or a raising of consciousness for your cause.
What's the quickest, cheapest way of getting awareness about where? And the idea behind the superheroes campaign was that every father is a superhero to his children.
Yeah.
And it's iconic. It was also meant to be ironic.
Yes.
If you put Batman on Buckingham Palace, everybody knows Batman, everybody knew Buckingham Palace. But it was also meant to be, in my head, when I'm dealing with, you know, my own depression, the suicide of dads, and a really difficult emotional stuff, my only way of getting through it, to be honest with you, Eamon, was to try and sugarcoat the pill by humour. If I could find some laughter in the misery, the super suits did it for me, because I thought overweight guys in Lycra, to me, was always, you know, we had so many funny stories about guys who would be on a gantry, motorway gantry, for example, and they'd be freezing cold, and they'd be worried about, well, what do I look like in my tights, and so there was a lot of amusing anecdotes. But the idea behind the campaign was using as little money as possible to get as much publicity as possible.
Now let me ask you at this stage, Matt, about your own children, the original two children, Alexander and
Daniel. Yeah.
You're estranged from them. How old are they now?
They're in their sort of 20s.
Yes.
So we've had a good relationship. We've had a difficult relationship, but that's more to do with issues that have happened in recent years. So there has been some difficulty, unfortunately, and a lot of that has related to you sort of hope things are resolved. You can never say anything's ever resolved when it comes to human relationships. But, you know, we're lucky in terms of when I went through Fathers for Justice, I met my wife, Nadine.
Yes.
At a Fathers for Justice meeting. I thought she was an undercover reporter.
Yes.
Would you believe it? And we've got a wonderful son, Archie, who's now 11. So out of the depths of difficulties that we've had in relationship up and down, I always try and find the positive in it. I think you've got to believe in hope, and you've also got to keep that hope alive for the people you're also helping.
Well, when you're in the Scottish Parliament, just a few days ago, you're lobbying to get politicians to reform the existing law.
Yeah.
And are you making progress?
We're making slow progress. You know, we've...
What are the forces that are holding you back? I mean, let me just speculate and tell me. Feminists?
Definitely feminism is...
There are people that I think have been called feminazis. Somebody accused John of coining that phrase, but I don't believe he did. But somebody did. There are extremes on all sides of cultural things. But there are women haters, and there are also, on the other side, men haters. Would it be fair to say that the unpopularity of your cause is because there's more evidence for the people who, you know, think men are bastards? That kind of is a summary of them. They drink too much. They don't give the kids their bath. They don't do their household stuff.
I think again that's a kind of prehistoric view.
Yeah, I know it's prehistoric, they go to football matches. Hold on a minute.
Yeah,
they go away for golfing weekends. Yeah. They go to Vegas on stag do's.
Also, women go on hen weekends. And
yeah, I know. Well, let's leave Vegas and the hen stag do's out. But they go to sport.
Yeah.
They're out of the house.
Yeah.
They go down the pub. They have a few drinks. They are generally, and I confess, irresponsible in terms of, you know, their parental duties. They have that tendency. Let's put it no stronger than that.
I just don't agree with that at all. I think that's a very, very crude stereotype. And I think if you need to look around Temple Bar most evenings and then make an assessment on a number of drunken men and women you see, I mean, it won't be quite as the disparity won't be as great as you as you suggest. I don't think that mums are Madonnas. I don't think dads are demons. They're good mums, bad mums, good dads, bad dads, and that's the reality of the life we live in. The reasons, though, why is there such resistance? Why is there such opposition? Firstly, the largest constituency of floating voters are mothers, are women. That's why in the UK, everybody goes and they have tea and jammy dodgers with the Mumsnet Brigade, you know, the women's groups out there. So, and women and feminists have become embedded, deeply, deeply embedded in government. So they're shaping government policy. Forget politicians. I'm talking about the what Gorbachev used to call the bureaucratic command structure of government.
Yes.
So that means the bureaucracy. And they are deeply embedded. So there is a kind of, there's an ideology at the heart of this, which basically says, look, you know, and it's an outdated ideology, but it's an ideology still the same, which says, you know, men are not important, that men can be disregarded, can be disrespected and treated like second-class citizens.
Based on all the bollocks I've just been spouting.
Well, I think, based on that, but it is an idea. You know, you speak to a lot of feminists, what I call the shihadists, who are out there. They hate men. I mean, they are men responsible for war, men of violence. It's thousands of years of evolution have led us to this point where men can't be trusted with children. And that results in the family courts here, where, you know, 97% of residencies are given to mums.
Yes.
And people say to me, oh, but the family courts don't discriminate. I said, 97% isn't discrimination. Really? What sort of country is this?
Can I ask you another question, Matt, about temperament? This is terrible stuff.
Don't ask me about temperament.
Would you agree with my knee-jerk feeling as our conversation unfolds that men and women are temperamentally different?
I'm going to use the example of me.
Am I revealing myself to just be ridiculous?
I definitely ridiculous. I think you're right. You know, if my dad was here, God rest his soul, he's buried in Sneem. You can see with my relatives, they struggle with what I do. You can see that they don't understand it, because they come from that era where this would never have been seen as being an issue. And so for them, it is, there's a big cultural difference.
Yeah.
You just see it. It just doesn't. It just doesn't figure. But look, I'll give you. I'll give you at home anecdotal evidence. My wife, brilliant woman, tough woman.
Yeah.
But I'm a lot softer and cuddly with my son.
Yes.
So we sit down, we cuddle.
Yeah.
I'm far more hands-on and tactile.
Yes.
Than she is.
Yes.
Now, obviously, I didn't give birth to him. But I'm probably have a different kind of relationship.
Yes.
To her. Now, you might
totally accept that. No, I understand. I understand it and I accept it unconditionally.
Yeah. And I think part of changing, not just changing the law, is also changing the way we're conditioned to think. Yes. About mothers and fathers and the roles of mothers and fathers. And I think that's an important part that needs to come with it.
So there is, let's say, and agree, I hope, that there is more opportunity. Women are liberated from a lot of the drudgery of that stuff, which we all want, which is good.
Yeah.
It's shared, the kind of drudgery of housework and stuff like that. Which is perfect and good.
Yeah.
Your cause, really, is to see this reflected in legal system, in the legal system. And that's where the kind of backward view of these things. I mean, the judges who make these calls are still stuck in the kind of mindset I was articulating. Didn't really mean it. I was only
You were just but you're right. Listen, I won't name anybody, but I was in the court recently in the west of Ireland with a particular judge who I won't name.
No.
And we're in there as a Mackenzie friend, which is helping a dad.
Yes.
A dad who'd been for a horrendous time, was experiencing severe kind of, emotional trauma as a result of not seeing his children. So we went in to assist him. And the judge stopped him from, prevented either of us from making any notes in court, so he couldn't make notes. The court order had been pre-written when we got in there.
Yes.
And he asked the mother what the issue was in terms of mum had said that there'd been some conflict between them. And he says, well, I've written this banning order. How long would you like the banning order to be?
Yeah.
She said, 3 years. I said, okay, but 3 years now. Signed off.
Yeah.
Incredible. I mean, absolutely incredible. There's no accountability, no transparency. Mm-hmm. This is the kind of secrecy that even Kim Jong-un would flinch at and go, really? This is just in a modern, so-called progressive democracy, we have a legal system that is operating on these principles with these kind of judges. It's completely wrong. Let me tell you, I'll finish that story off. So I complained to Frances Fitzgerald, wonderful woman. And she wrote back and said, there's not even a judicial complaints procedure. You can't even complain about a judge in this country. It doesn't exist. They're looking at setting it up. Really? Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
So we've got a long, long, long way to go.
Just finally, Matt, I perhaps it's remiss of me to be joking about this because it's deadly serious. Fathers for Justice and John Waters particularly has been supportive. I mean, what you're talking about here are people who are driven sometimes to suicide, sometimes to drink, but certainly to extreme loneliness, that feeling of being bereaved because you've lost the most precious thing in your life. And this is what your cause is, and this is what Fathers for Justice is involved in, counselling people, supporting people, as well as trying to get the law reformed.
We dealt with two suicides last week, and we deal with about on average one a week, and often the first we find out about it is we get a call from the funeral home. So it's an onerous responsibility to deal with, people's parents, for example. One of the guys last week had jumped off a cliff in the south of England last week, and you've got to speak to his parents about that kind of loss. And it's difficult. Yeah, it's a real burden. And what I try to say to politicians, and I try to say to you,
yes,
is men bleed, we cut, we hurt, we suffer pain, we grieve for our children. Mm-hmm. Every one of us is somebody's son,
yes,
somebody's brother, somebody's father, and people are dying. They are dying, and we do nothing about it. I can't, you know, I feel compelled. John feels compelled.
Yes.
Many of us feel compelled that we have to do whatever we can do to try and change that.
Okay, well, I hear you. I admire you and respect what you're trying to do. And wish you good luck in the future.
Thank you very much, Eamon.